Irak ve Suriye'de tahminen 100 ayrı ülkeden 25 bin savaşçının IŞİD saflarında savaştığını biliyoruz.
There is a major threat to the future of all countries combating terrorism, which is the fact of foreign fighters. Today, under ISIS, foreign fighters from 100 different countries, with a total of around 25,000 people, are actively fighting under the banner of ISIS.
Aslında terör ekonomik bir sektör haline dönüşmüş durumda.
And we can also see that terrorism has become an economic industry.
11 Eylül saldırılarından sonra Afganistan'ın işgaliyle birlikte terör tanımı da aslında amaçları yönünden değişti.
The way in which countries started defining terrorism after 9/11 have also been changing every day.
Özellikle daha önce terör örgütlerinin yapılanmalarına baktığımız zaman dikey yapılar görüyoruz. Emir komuta sistemi içinde bir yapılanma söz konusu.
When we look at the way in which terrorist organizations have been internally organizing themselves, we see a vertical structure with command.
11 Eylül saldırılarından sonra El-Kaide'nin doğuşuyla birlikte yatay örgütlenme şeklinde daha gevşek terör yapıları ortaya çıktı.
However, after 9/11, terrorist organizations started changing their structures from vertical to horizontal, which is a more loose form of being organized.
Aynı düşünceyi paylaşan radikal akımlar istedikleri ülkelerde istedikleri eylemi yapabilir duruma geldiler.
And through this horizontal structure, people, radicalized people, and people who identify with radicalized trends all across the globe, started committing attacks in whichever country they wanted to attack.
Bir nevi uyuyan hücrelere dönüştüler.
We see the formations of sleeping cells of these terrorist organizations as well.
En son Almanya'da olduğu gibi bir tırla kalabalığın içerisine girerek kendince düşündüğü eylemi gerçekleştirebilir duruma geldiler.
And these sleeping cells with this horizontal structure of terrorist organizations, they started attacking like we have seen recently in Germany. They could just get a truck and drive it into a crowd in order to achieve their ends.
Bunu İstanbul'daki El-Kaide saldırılarında da bombalı eylemlerde de gözlemleyebiliyoruz.
We also see the same structure being prevalent in attacks, bomb attacks that have happened in Istanbul.
Özellikle son dönemde Reyna'da ve İstanbul'da Vodafone stadı yanında olan terör eylemlerine baktığımızda burada birisi PKK terör grubu tarafından, diğeri de biraz önce de belirttiğim gibi terörist yabancı gruplar tarafından gerçekleştirilen.
There have been two recent attacks in Turkey, one in Dolmabahçe next to Vodafone Arena, and one in the nightclub on New Year's Eve at Reyna.
Artık IŞİD istediği zaman dünyanın herhangi bir yerinde bir terörist grupla iletişim kurabilir, onu bir başka ülkeye yönlendirerek orada eylem yaptırabilir.
And these both cases, these attacks are examples of how major international terrorist organizations are able to communicate with regional or country-based terrorist groups to organize the violent attacks in these countries.
Bu konu geleceğin dünyasında önemli bir sorun olarak ortaya çıkıyor.
This will arise as a major problem in the future.
Bu konuda sadece teröre maruz kalan ülkeler terörle mücadele etmemeli. Bu ülke vatandaşları da o ülkeler tarafından takip edilmeli ve uluslararası işbirliği ve istihbarat işbirliği sağlanmalıdır.
Not only countries who are receiving these attacks should be fighting against such terrorist structures in their neighborhoods or in their countries, but also countries who are where these terrorists or terrorist organizations are coming from should track their these terrorist organizations and share information with each other.
Tabii ki biliyoruz ki terörist eylemler neden Orta Doğu coğrafyasında, Asya'da ve Afrika'da meydana geliyor?
And we also know why terrorist organizations are founded in, especially in Middle East, Africa and Asia.
Baktığımızda görüyoruz ki o ülkenin stratejik durumu.
When we look at it, we see these regions and the countries in those regions, their strategic status.
Etnisite ve demografik durumu.
The ethnicities and demographies of these countries.
Ve yeraltı zenginliklerini ve enerji kaynaklarını görüyoruz.
And energy resources of these countries along with wealth.
Türkiye'nin bulunduğu coğrafyadaki petrol yataklarına, enerji kaynaklarına olan mesafesi ve stratejik konumu da aslında Türkiye'yi istikrarsız hale dönüştürerek amaçlarına ulaşmak isteyen ülkeler açısından bir fırsat yaratıyor.
In this slide, Turkey, since it's Turkey is a neighbor to oil-rich countries, these terrorist organizations aim at attacking Turkey to destabilize Turkish security.
Bu yönüyle de biraz önce Burak Hocam'ın da bahsettiği gibi.
In this aspect, as Burak Hoca have mentioned previously,
terörün iyisi kötüsü olmaz.
There is no good or bad terror.
Terör bir insanlık suçu olarak, insanların hayatına kasteden bir suç olarak dünyanın her tarafında, her ülke tarafından kabul edilmeli ve gerekli önleyici mekanizmalar ve mücadele mekanizmaları oluşturulmalıdır.
And this is why everyone, every international actor, every country, every state should accept terrorism as a crime against humanity and also actively participate in the formation of preventive mechanisms against terrorism.
Many thanks indeed for this broad overview, which I guess gives all of us who don't live in Turkey the a chance to really become acquainted more closely to the challenges presented by political violence and terrorism, and the numbers speak for themselves. We talk about 40,000 people lost. This is a really big numbers, over even though spread over many years. And so the challenges are very significant, and clearly the efforts to contain them, both at the law enforcement level, but also more broadly, to deprive, as the speaker just explained to us, terrorists of any base for political support. I think it's very, very important, so that you kind of take the oxygen, so to speak, out of the room, so where they have breathing ground and sanctuary in other countries beyond those where they operate. Let me now give the floor to my good friend and colleague here, Dr. Burak Kuntay, who is the president of the Center for American Studies at Bahcesehir University in Istanbul, Turkey.
First of all, I would like to welcome everyone here as the guest and as the host on behalf of GPI. It's a great meeting today. I was discussing with Chairman Paolo before the meeting. Almost my entire academic life, I have been visiting several different conferences all over the world, and we have been talking about terrorism, the global terrorism, international terrorism, regional terrorism. We always change the phrase, comes in front of the terrorism, but we keep on discussing it. In United Nations, the leaders are discussing it. In NATO, the leadership of the countries are discussing it. The world always gives some promising opinions about we have to fight against the terrorism together, we have to do this together, we have to do that together, terrorism is crime, terrorism is that, terrorism is this, but we keep on talking. Any outcome? No. Is it possible? With this mentality, impossible. Why? I would like to talk a couple things about this. But before I start, I would like to give you some facts about the recent issues. When I mean recent, I'm talking about briefly after September 11. Some numbers, not exact numbers, but some facts, let's say, to clear your mind more. In 2015 to 2016, the casualties, the victims of terrorism, raised over 15% in just 1 year. But the critical one, the critical fact is, in OECD countries, imagine, OECD countries, they're supposed to be a peace and prosperity over there, right? The terrorism, compared with 2 years ago, the total raises 650%. Not 65, not 6.5. 650% raise in OECD countries in the last 1 year. But we keep on talking in UN, everywhere, how to challenge, how to deal with this challenge. Şimdi, let's talk about this. How this global extreme terror find its roots in the very middle of the world? That's one. What kind of regions or what kind of possibilities are giving a safe haven to this mentality? Because more than everything, more than an action, that's a mentality. And the third one, what is keeping them alive? If we criticize this once again, which we already know, by the way, I'm just going to remind you, then we will find our path to solve this problem, actually. But then the real risky part is going to come at the end that I'm going to mention. Do we really want to solve it? Because I don't see the real intent in the world to take an action about this. I'll talk about this when it comes to the end. Look, when you look at the numbers, it says that countries who have been suffering with economic problems, their growth rate, their economic capacities, their democracy rates, if they are below, it's a very important gateway for terror to grow over there. That's a fact. Two, if there's any ongoing ethnic, because the main thing about the global terror is based from either ethnic, religious, or linguistic sects. So if there's any lifelong, at least 50 to 100 or 200 years long, issues, conflicts like this in the world, I'm not talking about economic though, either religious, ethnic, or linguistic sects, there's obviously another safe haven for this. That's number two. Three, and I believe the most important reason to have a radical terror to grow in a specific place. If the genetics, as we call this in Turkey, GDO, if you play with the genetics of the region, of an ethnic group, of a country, of a religious group, of a linguistic group, everything is messed up. What I mean? I can give you a couple good examples about that. Did you pay attention, especially in the past 20 years, mainly what region of the world is creating the terror events, exporting it, and mainly becoming the safe haven? When you look at the area, it is mainly Syria, Iraq, and a little bit south of that region. Am I right? Why? You have to go, in order to understand this, to Sykes-Picot. If you want to understand this, you have to go to Balfour. If you want to understand it, you have to go to McMahon. If you want to understand it, you have to go to the end of the First World War. So imagine, I always tell this to my students in the university, I said that, who's the first leader of Syria, the modern Syria? They said, who? I said, the king of Iraq. They're like, what? I'm pretty sure you know the story. The king, actually not king at that time, the Sherif Hussein, the eminent governor of Ottoman Empire of the Hijaz vilayet, the area, he has sons. And according to the British-Arab correspondence, we also call this McMahon Agreement, it was promised to Sherif Hussein, after, if you fight against the Ottoman Empire, you will get the areas of Iraq, Syria, you know, this region. Sherif Hussein said, cool, good agreement, I'm going for it. So there's a serious clash between Turks and the Arabs, at that specific time. And what happened was the promised land, Syria, Damascus, was given by British to Sharif Hussein. Sharif Hussein sent his son, Faisal, to Syria. We all know this, right? Faisal said, okay, I'm the king of Syria. Next day, French, by getting their support from the Sykes-Picot Agreement, they signed with British again. They said that, whoa, this was promised to us, not to Faisal. I'm getting there. And they said, Faisal, please move, my friend. He said, no, I'm the king of Syria. Then the first bombing to the city, Faisal immediately moved to Iraq and became the king of Iraq. Okay, I'm the king of Iraq now. It sounds funny, right? Can you be the king of a country in 2 minutes and then switch to the other country and become the king of that country in 5 minutes? If you play with the genetics of the region, then don't expect anything to happen next moment. The areas that we are suffering from terrorism today is all the areas that certain powers in the world at that time, I'm talking about 100 years ago, tried to play with the genetics, with the maps, with the ethnicities. They said that, look at the Syria or the Iraq map, perfect, good squares or rectangles. They said that, okay, you are Iraqi now. You are Syrian now. Did you check out the Damascus culture? Have you ever checked out the Abbasites or the Amorites cultures over there? Have you ever checked out the Shi'i culture, how it affecting during the Safavites? Before, I'm not talking about the current Persian establishment in Kashgars or something like that. I'm talking about the Safavites. I'm talking about, before that, the Meds, the Ahamenics. Now, you are Syria now. You are this, you are that. Şimdi, that's the main problem. While we think this is going to be solved, while we think this is becoming a little bit mature and things are going to be better and the people of that countries are going to find their own revolutions, and find their own democracies, boom, September 11. Not the September 11 is the problem over there. The actions after September 11 is the problem over there. I was the student body president of Florida Atlantic University at that time. I was in my office. I turn on TV. I see that a plane crashed in a building. I said, what an accident. Have you ever seen a terror attack like this? That should be an accident. Couple minutes later, when the second one hit, we said that, oops, that might not be an accident or a big coincidence. Everybody was sympathetic to what happened in this country. I mean, that's the biggest crime. 3,000 people in one day, families, and it was catastrophic. I even feel that pain like that day today. But the actions took place after that event made United States credibility and the moral leadership in the world to go backwards. Saddam Hussein gone. Okay, now let's form a coalition. By the way, Saddam is not a saint, or Bashar Assad, or Hafez Assad, or all the guys before them. But when you try to imitate the region, Bremer, Garner, you remember these names, right? It's already 20 years, but we get used to these names. Immediately, okay, now this is going to be the Turkmen area, this is going to be the Shia area, you're going to control the parliament, you will have 60%, this doesn't happen like this. If you try to imitate a region, if you try to imitate a country with your own drawings, miles and miles and miles away from that country, what happens is the natural reaction by the people who find themselves outside of the system creates a gap. And that gap, yesterday, get together under Taliban, a day before under something else, day after Al-Nusra, then Al-Qaeda, then this, then that, today ISIS. Tomorrow it's going to be something else. Because as long as you try to manage a country, a region, a people, and try to draw maps with your hands, try to fit people inside it and tell them how to fix their system, unless they digest it with their own will, it doesn't happen. It doesn't happen. It causes problem. So the very first thing I'm going to say is, as long as some countries, according to their own national interest, which I also doubt if it is really your national interest, that creates the main problem in global and extreme terror. That's number one. Number two, you have to know something so well in global politics. Someone you use today to fix your problem might be your problem next day. Let me give you a good and beautiful, I love this, timeline. For instance, we saw a lot of ideas and opinions during the Greenbelt theory era, during the Cold War. Basically, in the United States, this was discussed, and the Mujahideen in Afghanistan were used against the Russians. Why? Because when you look at the sociological concept of Islam, it is opposite with communism. So you can use the Islamic groups in Afghanistan to fight with communism so well. It works good. And pretty much United States did this. Was it successful? Yep. But once Russia is gone, not Russia, sorry, Soviet Union is gone, when technically communism is not around anymore, what happened? The people you trained need somewhere and some other ideology to hit. And suddenly it caused September 11.
Ideologies and preaching, and they seem to believe that this is really a good idea and a good thing to follow and engage, in some instances at least, in terror attacks. Well, I would submit to you that their biggest ally in the West is the media. Because the media tends to, glorify as in exalting, but certainly to make these events appear enormous, life-threatening, existential threats. We're done, we're finished. I just give you one practical example. After the San Bernardino attacks, right, a couple of years ago in California, and you remember, again, this couple who engaged in, you know, they went shooting people and killed a lot of them. I remember distinctly one television commentator who happens to be somebody in, with law enforcement background, who was a prosecutor, who said, "This is it. We're done. We're finished. Save yourselves. This is just a matter of survival." And this is somebody talking to millions of people on television. "Here's my advice to you. Go out, buy yourself a gun, because this is it. This is going to be a door-to-door fight." And I said, "Okay, wait a minute. Really? This is not true." In other words, there was a level of exaggeration that which tends to do this. You portray these people again and again on television. You show their pictures. You show their videos, their Facebook postings. And we forget one particular element, at least in the frame of mind of these self-radicalized individuals. Yes, they fight for their own cause, however they define it. But, and this may not sound, may sound a little strange, among other things, they want to be famous. They really want the limelight. They want the recognition. They want to know, yes, I am engaged in this suicide mission. I'm going to die, but the whole world is going to talk about me. And my family will be proud of me because I'm a hero. I'm a martyr. I died for the cause. It was an interesting piece of information, and I just saw it a couple of days ago, and I thought it was fitting to bring it to your attention in the context of this meeting today. And there is a very interesting article, and I find it interesting the placement of the article. Some of you, maybe not our foreign guests, but this is Wired Magazine, right? Now, what's Wired Magazine? It's probably one of the preeminent journals of innovation, high technology, information technology, and what have you. So, very sophisticated journal of new ideas and whatnot. But what is interesting is that there is a very big story that says, in the current issue, that says, "Can you turn a terrorist back into a citizen?" And it portrays at least the endeavors of here's the headline, as you can see, quite big, all right? The endeavors of a German scholar who has tried to work with radical youth, okay, in Germany first, and then, and he claims that he has developed some kind of a formula, a scientific method to rearrange, if you wish, the way of thinking of radicalized young people. And apparently, he has tested this proposition among Somali youth in Minneapolis here in this country. There's a very large concentration of Somali immigrants, and it so happened that many of them, young people, sometimes maybe second generation Somalis, have been sort of converted to radicalism, and many of them tried or succeeded in going to Syria or Afghanistan or other places to fight for their good cause, for the caliphate, for ISIL, whatever. Well, this gentleman claims that he's got this formula, and he has worked with law enforcement in Minneapolis and elsewhere, and he's got his idea. Anyway, it's a very long article. If you want to find out whether this is just an interesting journalism piece or whether there's something to it, I recommend it to you. Wired magazine, can you turn a terrorist back into a citizen? I think it's a lot probably more complicated than the article would like to portray, but you can decide for yourselves. If I may just ask you a follow-up question based on this, exactly the last point you've made, we need to find common understanding and a common base with which to deal with the problem.
Bir fikir birliğine sahip olmamız gerekiyor terörizmi nasıl anladığımıza dair ve terörizme nasıl savaşacağımıza dair. Bu son noktayla bitirdiniz konuşmanızı.
Let me ask you an operational question. You
are bir sorum olacak.
You are a law enforcement person, you know, an action man in to some extent, right?
Siz bir aksiyon adamısınız. Emniyet güçlerinde önemli yerlerde görev aldınız.
We are now in the United States, as you know, under new management, so to speak.
Bildiğiniz üzere Amerika Birleşik Devletleri'ne yeni bir yönetim geldi.
We have a brand new administration that will engineer its own, you know, and declare to the American public and to the world its foreign policy priorities.
Başkan Trump'a 3 ya da 2 maddelik bir liste verseniz, terörizme karşı mücadele de hem Amerika'nın hem de Amerika'nın müttefiklerine yardımcı olabileceği noktalar anlamında.
What would be your wish list? Two or three things, the key points that you think should be absolutely high priority for the United States to help in this global war against terrorism.
ABD'nin hem kendisi hem de müttefiklerine bu küresel terörizme karşı mücadelesinde yardımcı olabilecek üç önemli öncelikli nokta ne olur?
Öncelikle dünyada terör olaylarının olduğu ülkeleri, istikrarsız alanları görebiliyoruz.
First of all, we can clearly see the countries and regions where there is instability and terrorist formations.
Bütün paydaşlarımızla, ortaklarımızla terörü yok etmek üzere ortak bir akıl ve yöntem oluştururduk.
First of all, I would recommend that we sit down together with our allies and our partners from across the globe and come up with a common method and common understanding of terrorism.
Dünyadan terörizmi yok etmek için ne gerekiyorsa bütün ülkelerle konuşur ve Birleşmiş Milletleri de sistemin içerisine dahil ederek önlemeye çalışırdı.
And I would ask for the commitment of all participating countries in this fight against global terrorism, including United Nations, that they do whatever they can to fight global terrorism.
Çünkü dünyada barış ve güvenliği sağlayamadığımız zaman dünyanın hiçbir yerinde hiçbir ülke güvenli olmayacaktır.
Because if we cannot establish a global peace and global security, then no country is truly secure or can enjoy peace.
Trump ülkesini güçlü tutmak istiyor, ekonomik olarak daha da güçlenmek istiyor. Ama dünyada barış sağlanmadığı sürece Amerika'nın kendi sınırları içerisinde güçlenmesi de mümkün olmayacaktır.
Trump wants to make America great again, wants to make its economy grow and solidify its economic means. However, unless there is a global security with the defeat of global terrorism, even USA cannot be safe in its own borders.
Özellikle bölgemizde demokrasiyle yönetilen tek ülke olan Türkiye Cumhurbaşkanlığı ile çok yakın işbirliği yapmasını düşünür ve Türkiye ile mutlaka Orta Doğu coğrafyasında yapacağı barış sağlayıcı çalışmalarda Türkiye'nin desteğini almasını isterdim.
I would advise,
birlikte çalışmalarını isterdim.
I would advise Trump that he works closely with the president of Turkey, which is the only democracy in the region, in its efforts to bring peace and stability to the Middle East. So close cooperation and partnership in fighting terrorism in the Middle East is important for Turkey and the US.
Bir atasözü var. Yurtta sulh, cihanda sulh. Mustafa Kemal Atatürk'ün sözü. Bunun uygulanmasını dünyada evrensel olarak uygulanmasını sağlardım.
There is one important saying by Mustafa Kemal Atatürk. Peace in my country, peace around the globe. So in order to achieve this, in order to realize this saying, I would do all that I can.
Daha güvenli, daha mutlu insanların yaşadığı bir dünya düzeni için çalışın derdim.
I would recommend everyone, not only Trump, but all the leaders and countries around the globe, to work harder, to have happier and more secure societies around the globe.
Thank you.
Teşekkür ederim.
Thank you very much. We have a